continuing our study, our exploration of the Gospel of Matthew. And specifically, right now, we're in the passage in the Gospel of Matthew called the Sermon on the Mount. We're looking at some words from Matthew chapter 6, verses 1 through 18. So you can find this on page 684 of your Pew Bible, or you can follow along on the screen. Jesus is speaking to the crowds that have gathered to hear him preach. Be careful not to do your acts of righteousness before men to be seen by them. If you do, you will have no reward from your Father in heaven. So when you give to the needy, do not announce it with trumpets, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and on the streets, to be honored by men. I tell you the truth, they have received their reward in full. But when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret. Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. And when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the street corners to be seen by men. I tell you the truth, they have received their reward in full. But when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father, who is unseen. Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. And when you pray, do not keep on babbling like pagans, for they think they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. This then is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For if you forgive men when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins. When you fast, do not look somber as the hypocrites do, for they disfigure their faces to show men they are fasting. I tell you the truth, they have received their reward in full. But when you fast, put oil on your head and wash your face, so that it will not be obvious to men that you are fasting, but only to your Father who is unseen. And your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. Please pray with me. God, we thank you for your word. These words that come to us from your Son, Jesus, and that are just as powerful for us today, just as true for us today as any group of people, any audience that has listened to these words or read these words throughout the thousands of years since he spoke. So God, we pray that as we gather around your word today, as we reflect on what these words might mean for us, you would use this time to shape us and inform us, to draw us closer to yourself, that we might be the people you've called us to be. It's in your Son's name we pray these things. Amen. As the first few months of a new year unfold, not just in the United States, but around the world, the media abounds with stories about new leaders emerging in various countries, new endeavors being undertaken, new policies and laws that are being enacted on a number of fronts. And one such policy, kind of a new law that has gotten some attention in the international media, comes out of France. Earlier this year, French lawmakers put into effect a law regulating the use of email by businesses. Specifically, the law, which has been called the Right to Disconnect Bill, addresses the measure to which employers use email for company business after office hours. So the bill states that any company with more than 50 employees will be required to establish certain hours. These hours will usually be in the evening and on weekends, when sending, receiving, or responding to work-related emails is forbidden. Now, the motivation for this law is understandable. Anybody who has witnessed the proliferation of smartphones and tablets and other mobile devices that allow us to take our digital lives everywhere we go, from our homes to restaurants to the local park where we play with our kids. Anyone who has witnessed this knows that we humans in the 21st century have become profoundly attached to our electronic means of communication. And while much of our time online is spent looking at movie reviews and cat videos and Facebook profiles, employers have also picked up on this, and employers have undoubtedly taken advantage of the constant access they have to their workers. They've learned to make the most of the time that their employees will be plugged in. They know that when their employees leave the office, they don't leave their computers behind. They take their electronic and digital life with them wherever they go. And as research has found, these habits can have negative effects on our relationships, on our human interaction, maybe even on our health. And so this law coming out of France seeks to put an end to such practices, or at least to curb them. This law hopes that this move will help to create a context of rest and sanity for French citizens who are overworked and overly stressed. But while this law was greeted with enthusiasm by many, it has its critics as well. And primarily, these voices of opposition say that the law actually won't do much to address the concerns at hand. See, the real problem can't be easily disposed with a neat, tidy policy that dictates a schedule for our productivity. The real problem goes much, much deeper than that. The real problem rests in the fact that we've created a culture that is so reliant on being constantly connected. And so those who participate in this culture, which to some degree is most of us, we tend to develop habits of anxiety and unsettledness associated with our need always to be linked in with those around us. Our friends, our co-workers, and maybe even our competitors. We all kind of know what it feels like when we realize we don't have our phone on us, or we don't have access to email or to some form of communication like that. And so being told that we can't do that from 8 p.m. to 8 a.m. on a Tuesday won't really get at the heart of the matter. See, in a world where we expect and we've come to depend on constant connection with everyone and everything going on around us, the act of telling us that we have permission to disconnect won't go very far, because we don't really know what it means to disconnect, to be solitary. We don't know what it means to be still or to be undistracted. And we certainly don't know how to get there. Well, we're taking a few weeks here to get a sort of big picture view of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. And we're looking at this sermon as kind of a constitution for the kingdom of God, a statement not just of purpose, but a statement of identity for people who are called to live out the new covenant. And so last week we looked at what Jesus' Sermon on the Mount has to say to God's people about the matter of justice, the ways that we live justly or unjustly toward those around us. And this week, as we turn to Matthew chapter 6, we'll talk about another aspect of the Christian life. We're going to talk about the element of piety. And as has been mentioned a couple of times this morning, piety is a word that we don't use very often. It's certainly a word that is much less popular these days than justice. And while it is important that we talk about justice, it's kind of a shame that we don't talk enough about the idea of piety as the Bible talks about it. Because as the Bible demonstrates and as Christian history demonstrates, as our own experiences illustrate, piety and justice are inextricably bound together. The way that we live ethically in community flows out of the way that we embrace piety. The ways we act in the world around us will flow out of times of prayer and times of that commitment and that closeness to God that a life of piety develops. Some of our greatest Christian thinkers, men like G.K. Chesterton and C.S. Lewis, have argued that if the Christian life is going to be the rich, deep sort of life that God intends it to be, then the idea of piety needs to be kind of pulled off the shelf, dusted off, recovered, rescued from the image that so often attends it, an image of a kind of timid or ineffectual or passive life, so that people might realize that the pious heart, the heart that is oriented toward relationship with God, is in fact the heart that is most capable of engaging this robust and powerful life that God intends for his children. And so here in the second chapter of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, it shouldn't be surprising that Jesus spends a number of verses casting a vision, not both of how people should live in the world, but also about the matter of piety, of right worship, of right spiritual practice. And in doing so, Jesus continues to articulate the kind of posture toward God that gives life and gives shape and gives meaning to everything else that we do. Now, if we want to discern a principle that is at work in this chapter, in what Jesus has to say about our practices of piety, we might want to start with the idea that this recent French law tries and maybe according to some, fails to address. The importance of disconnecting. Or maybe to be more precise, what we want to think about is the importance of disconnecting from the wrong sorts of things so that we might be more connected to the right sorts of things. Be careful not to do your acts of righteousness before men to be seen by them, Jesus says in verse 1. For if you do, you will receive no reward from your Father in heaven. Now throughout much of the rest of what Jesus has to say in this section, he addresses some of the most fundamental of these acts of righteousness. He addresses some of the most essential aspects of Christian piety, some of the most essential practices that followers of God in his day and in ours would have engaged in. And as both his friends and his enemies would have already come to expect, Jesus is going to address these things in a way that shakes up their perspective. He's going to offer a corrective to some of the misguided ways that we go about pursuing our relationship to God. Well, first up is charity, the giving of alms. Now, specifically, Jesus is talking about the practice of sharing our financial resources with the poor. And so we can see right off the bat about how these spiritual practices that Jesus is talking about are very much bound up with our ways of living justly, our ways of living in kindness and mercy towards our neighbor. Well, Jesus says, when you give to the needy, do not announce it with trumpets, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and on the streets. Now, the specific targets of Jesus' judgment here, the hypocrites that he mentions, might be unknown to us, but we could probably assume that at least some of them might have been standing in the audience. We probably would have found them among the Pharisees and Sadducees and teachers of the law, but also maybe among some of the other people in Jesus' world who had opposed the ministry of John the Baptist and were now all set to oppose Jesus' ministry. In the last chapter, Jesus had talked about the need for the righteousness of his followers to surpass the righteousness of the Pharisees and the teachers of the law. He had talked about what that looks like in the way we follow the commandments. And here he gives another example of what that might look like. Apparently, when these people gave out of their resources towards the poor among them, their egos reveled in the boost they got from recognition. Their egos rejoiced in this even more than their hearts delighted in the opportunity to show loving generosity to their neighbor. Jesus describes their giving as accompanied by trumpets. I think Jesus is kind of being funny here. As the fourth century theologian John Chrysostom writes, Jesus was probably exaggerating a little bit to illustrate a point. He says, not that they really had trumpets, but Jesus means to display the greatness of their frenzy by the use of this figure of speech, deriding and making a show of them. In other words, Jesus was trying to take these people down a notch. He was trying to mock the thing in which they took the greatest pride, their outward displays of righteousness. And Jesus does this because those are the very things that are preventing them from true piety. Their pride in these outward displays is exactly what is preventing them from true service to God and true love towards their neighbors. Instead, Jesus says, and here he employs another figure of speech, he says, when you give, don't let your left hand know what your right hand is doing. In other words, give quietly. Look for opportunities to give that deflect the attention away from you as the giver, so that God might receive the glory, both in your life and in the lives of those you help. Now, this perspective on the piety of his followers is on further display as Jesus moves to discuss an even more fundamental spiritual practice. Prayer. From the earliest days of the Hebrew covenant, prayer occupied a central position in the life of God's people. If we even skim through the Psalms, we find an abundance of ways that followers of Yahweh poured out their hearts and their souls to their Heavenly Father in moments of contemplation and conversation. But in the hands of some of the religious leaders in Jesus' day, it seems that prayer had taken a new shape. You can almost see Jesus smirking as he talks about the hypocrites, the two-faced would-be shepherds of God's people, standing on the street corners, lifting their voices above the din of traffic and babbling, not so that God can hear them, but so that everyone else can. The Pharisee in Jesus' parable, which he'll tell later, the Pharisee who goes to the temple and prays and thanks God for making him so great, He thanks God that he, the Pharisee, performs all kinds of good works. This gives us some kind of idea of the kind of prayer that Jesus is condemning here. It's a pompous, self-serving, preachy prayer, rather than a genuine, humble moment of confession, or of thanksgiving, or of supplication. Now, the models for prayer that Jesus offers instead include withdrawing to an inner room, going to a quiet place, and praying simply and straightforwardly to the one who hears, the one who understands all of our hopes, all of our fears, all of our requests. And for the record, I don't think that Jesus is condemning public prayer. There's a long tradition, it's found in both the Old and the New Testaments, of God's people coming together as a group to join their prayers together, to speak to God both out loud and in the silence of their hearts as a community, so that they might be united in their petitions and united in their adoration. It's something that is a fixture of Christian gatherings throughout history. And I don't think that Jesus is condemning this. I don't think Jesus is condemning prepared prayers either, or even written prayers. There's a long history, both in the Old and the New Testament, and continuing to today, of praying in psalms. And that attests to the importance of these kinds of prayers in the life of God's people. Instead, I think what Jesus is doing here is he's encouraging followers to check themselves. He's encouraging followers to evaluate their attitudes, to think about, who is this for? For whose benefit am I offering up prayers? Now, if when we're honest, the answer is that we're doing it for all those who might be listening, because our public prayers, our prayers out loud, will be seen as a referendum on how holy or how mature or how godly we are, well, then that's an occasion for rethinking our prayer lives. And then finally, Jesus addresses a practice that isn't as common in our own religious climate as prayer and charity, but maybe it should be. He talks about fasting. And numerous commentators have pointed out here that Jesus says, when you fast, rather than if you fast. And that's a good point, because it illustrates that for the faithful people of Jesus' day, regular fasting was a practice that was almost taken for granted. It was built into their devotional lives. Not just on big, high, holy days, but as a twice a week, as a regular opportunity to abstain from food and other things in order to devote themselves to prayer. People in Jesus' day knew that fasting was hard. They also knew that fasting had certain powerful benefits. But Jesus wants to point out, just as he does with charity and with prayer, if we're not careful about our motives and our methods, we might find ourselves missing the point entirely. Just like the trumpets in the first example and the babbling in the second, Jesus gives us another image here. It's an image that is meant to be funny. It's meant to be kind of derisive, even mocking in its tone. He describes someone who disfigures his face in order to let people know how miserable he is while he's fasting. Look at how sacrificial I am. Won't God be happy with me since I'm giving up so much for him? Is that what God wants? Jesus asks. No. Jesus says that the one who fasts shouldn't use it as a platform to talk about his own achievement. Instead, the one who fasts, the one who gives something up, should use it as an opportunity to focus on what's important, to turn within in order to pray. Or in the case of something like the 30-hour famine, which our youth are going to be participating in, to turn our thoughts outward, to fast so that we might think about those who suffer in the midst of real hunger. But in both cases, the focus is not on the self. Now again, Jesus isn't being a legalist here. We don't have to pretend we're eating if we're not. If someone asks us about a fast, we don't have to lie to them. And again, things like the 30-hour famine, which are designed to raise awareness, require that we talk about fasting. But they require that we talk about it in a way that can be helpful rather than harmful. But Jesus wants to warn us against making our fasting or about making any sort of act of righteousness, anything we might give up or do for the kingdom, about ourselves and about being seen by others. And that seems to be kind of the common theme that Jesus is engaging here throughout this discussion of piety. It's about disconnecting from the things that vie for our love. It's about disconnecting from the approval of others, the ego boost that comes from hearing the praise of our friends and neighbors, the anxiety that comes with worrying what people think of us, whether they think we're adequately spiritual or religious enough. The tendency, which is so common in our world and maybe in our lives, to make everything about us. The tendency to revel in recognition. Disconnecting from these things is not the easiest thing for us to do. In our hyper-connected world, there are countless forums where this takes place. In Jesus' day, he talked about standing on the street corner, standing in the synagogue. In our day, he might say something like, when you give to the needy, don't plaster it all over your Twitter feed. When you pray, don't broadcast it in your Facebook profile photo. When you fast, you don't have to podcast about it. Let these practices provide opportunities to disconnect. To disconnect from the things that culture and our own sinful tendencies tell us are so important. So that we can connect with what really matters. It's okay. We have permission, Jesus is saying, to do some things without worrying about how many people are going to see us. It's okay to engage in some things without worrying about whether people will offer up their praise for us when we do. In fact, this is healthy. I would say that for the Christian life, it's necessary. When we embrace these kind of attitudes toward our life in Christ, we'll find that these works of piety, these acts of righteousness that Jesus talks about, while they might be private, actually have far-reaching consequences. When Jesus withdrew to a quiet place to pray, he did so in order that he might connect with his Father, but also so that he might serve others more effectively. When we fast, when we give, when we lay out our supplications and petitions before God, we will be making a difference in the world. Even if it doesn't get our name on the side of the building. Even if no one writes a book about us. Even if we don't get so much as a pat on the back from an admiring friend. In Jesus' vision of the kingdom, these things are not why we do what we do. In Jesus' vision of the kingdom, it's the simple, humble, quiet act of service, or prayer, or sacrifice, that delights our Heavenly Father, and that keeps us connected to the author and the source of our life. Please pray. God, we thank you that in a world that constantly puts pressure on us to worry about what others think, in a world that constantly puts pressure on us to want to impress others, to want to make ourselves known, we thank you, Lord, that your Son gives us permission to let go of that. To let go of that constant and exhausting need. God, we thank you that things like prayer, things like service, things like fasting, things like charity, things that you call us to do simply as part of your people can be more about the ways that they foster your love within us, more about the ways they foster our commitments to you, more about strengthening us in your purpose, in your will for us, that we might be more faithful in the ways we engage with the world around us and in the ways we give you glory. God, I will be the first to confess that I struggle, as so many people do, with anxieties about what people think, the insecurities that come with that. And so, Father, I thank you for the liberation that comes with knowing that in prayer I can simply rest in you. In the times when I seek you, in whatever way, whatever way you call me to do so, Lord, I can connect with you. And that in that, I'll be doing so for the good of your kingdom, for the good of this world. God, help us to learn that. Help us to grow in that, not just as individuals, but as a community, that we might strengthen one another as we seek to grow in a deeper love, a deeper commitment, deeper friendship, and deeper service with you. It's in the name of your Son, Jesus, that we pray all of these things. Amen.